Hey guys, it's Adam Gussow from, yeah, I know, I had somebody tell me, you know, you always say it's Adam Gussow from Satan and Adam. Why do you do that? I think it's to maintain brand identity, but the truth is, I'm really proud of the many years, 12 years that I put in playing with Sterling McGee, Mr. Satan, and I'm really psyched up right now because I'm going on the road, baby, tomorrow, going off on the road, and I'm going to be playing with Sterling on Friday. I'm picking him up at the airport, and we're going to have such a good time Friday night. At Terra Blues, we're going to have a documentary film crew there. We're going to have a new record label there. We're going to have a book publication party. I can't believe it. It's just going to be great. We're going to have a friend, I think, playing some percussion with us. His name is Dave on drums. So if you show up, expect there's going to be a little shift in the personnel, and it should be really fun, though. It should be really fun. On Saturday, this is Saturday, June 2nd. If our plans hold, and I want to let all of you guys know about this, this could be really, really, really cool. We are planning to go up to Harlem, where we have not played on the street in at least a decade. I think it's been longer than that, maybe 11 or 12 years. And we're going to go up there, and we're going to maybe try it on 125th Street at some point in early to mid-afternoon. If you guys are in New York, any of you who watch this and are planning on being at the party on Friday night, you should know that on Saturday afternoon from noon to 5, there's a very famous event. It's the 29th annual Mississippi Picnic. It's people like me who teach at Ole Miss or alumni from the University of Mississippi. It's renegade Mississippians who happen to find themselves beached in New York City. And there's a big picnic, and it's not by invitation. As far as I know, you should go and Google this. Just put Mississippi Picnic, and it'll show up right away. Hold on a sec. So, Mississippi Picnic. We are going to go. We're going to hang out a little bit at the Mississippi Picnic in New York, in Central Park. It's in the 90s, right on the east side of Central Park. Catfish, I think my friend John Paris, I saw something to convince me on his website that he's playing guitar, so you might even see a little Satan and Adam there, playing or not. But then we're going to go up to Harlem, and we're going to set up on 125th Street, or alternately on 7th Avenue between 121st and 122nd Street, I believe. It's where Sterling had what he called his throne. So it's an incredibly exciting weekend coming up, and I can hardly stand it. I'm practicing, and I'm ready for this. And I got a brand new Hohner Marine Band Key of C. And it sounds really good. I don't even want to think about playing my B-flat now because this C sounds so good. Just check this out. Perfectly in tune when I put this baby on my... Wow. Now, you see, what you want if you're going to amplify harp is you want that kind of high mid-range, that saturation. You want it bright but not too shrieky trebly. And this one has exactly what I want. It's right on the edge of feedback, but, of course, the amp is just right back there. But I'm going to give you a quick little lesson on one really cool thing that I like to do on the harp. It's something that I use when I play Whammer Jammer. It's basically a kind of juke joint harp trick. It's the only time that I consistently play the three-hole blow on the harp. Now, I know a lot of you guys and gals, I don't want to just pick on the men here. Gals have bad habits. A lot of you tend to play... That's wrong. You don't want to play the three-hole blow. You almost never want to play the three-hole blow as a melody note on the harp. And the reason for that is because it becomes very hard to coordinate in and out chord rhythms if you're doing that. Because the strongest melody notes are, of course, all draw. So you don't want to play a melody note on the blow. This doesn't make any sense, does it? Okay, anyway, but here's the trick, okay? The only time that I play the blow on the three-hole is something like this. Now, what did I just do? Oh man, now that is a really cool lick, right? And when I amplify it, and I could do a little glissando. Okay. I'm doing. I'm starting on the one draw, and I'm doing it with my tongue on the roof of my mouth. I'm doing the two blow, then the three blow, then the two blow, and that's the lick. It's two blow, three blow, two blow, but also starting usually on the one draw. Now, what I just did there, one draw, do it twice, two blow, three blow, two blow. Now, if you don't know harp real well, what you're going to do to kind of get back to home base is you're going to go back down to the one draw, and then back up to two draw. Now, what do I do? Well, this is a subtlety. You get that? See, now, if I wasn't slowing this stuff down, this is the, you know, it's the pros. They're trying to mystify you. They're not trying to actually tell you what they do. Because if they did, you might practice a lot, get good, and then steal our gigs. Well, guess what? If you get good, you'll tell people where you learned it, right? Okay. So, what am I doing? You get that? Let me do it real slow. That's it. This is the machine language of the harp. So I'm going, I'm blowing, puffing on the two-hole blow. And then I'm releasing with the left side of my mouth. As I do that, I'm attacking it with my tongue, but opening my mouth at the same time. And then I'm coming right back in and nailing the two-hole draw, all sealed back down. So this is the lick. And if I glissando down to the one, and if I amplify it, and if I put a little digital delay on it, how about that? Can't do any more for you. I've given it all away. I said I was going to do it. See some of you guys in New York. I'm hitting the road tomorrow. Bye-bye.